Tullamore Musical Society has been bringing musicals, concerts, recitals and hours of entertainment to the town and surrounding areas for over 65 years. During this time, it has gone through countless committee members, cast members, front of house staff, stage crew, box office staff and many, many more. In this documentary, we take a look back at some of the most memorable shows and people that we have seen with the Musical Society for the last 65 years. Tullamore Musical Society's first ever production was in 1955. However, the roots of the society go back 12 years previous to the founding of the Local Lights in 1942. This was a great dramatic outlet for the town and led to the creation of many variety groups and drama groups, including the Runners and, of course, Tullamore Musical Society. A founder member of the Local Lights and on the first committee of Tullamore Musical Society was Jack Hughes.
Daddy was on the committee that time, 1955, and it was the first musical, and they had split from the Local Lights. That was another group that was in town. And he was on the committees himself and his brother, my Uncle Willie, and down the years. And then he was elected president, and he was the first layman president. It was always usually the PP, the parish priest, or one of the clergy was president. But Daddy was first layman to be president of the Musical Society.
The 20th and 21st of May 1955, the Society presented Gilbert and Sullivan's short opera Trial by Jury in the Grand Central Cinema. In 1957, the Society staged a production of The Geisha, and this saw a debut for a man who would become one of the longest-serving members and most distinguished leading men in the Society, Paddy Norton.
Yeah, for years when asked my name, I would reply, Paul Norton, and inevitably I would be then asked, are you related to the singer? My dad was known as Paddy Norton, the singer. He joined the Society in 1957. He played many, many roles through the years. Daddy's favourite roles would have been the Baron in The Gypsy Baron and the Red Shadow in The Desert Song. Daddy had a theory, which I would call a gift, where he would say that the more difficult the sing was, the more he would enjoy the role. This was definitely not a gift passed on to me.
During the rest of the 1950s, the Society went on to perform some pantomimes such as Robinson Crusoe, Jack and the Beanstalk and Cinderella. In 1962, the Society returned to the traditional musicals with a presentation of The Desert Song. In this year, we were introduced to two wonderful comedic actors who came together and left a legacy across musical theatre and variety performance in the Midlands.
1962 was a very eventful year. I joined Tullamore Musical Society for their production of The Desert Song. And even though I was born and reared in Tullamore, I was still a little apprehensive at meeting this talented group. But I needn't have worried, they made me feel very welcome. And in fact, I met Richie Rex, who was to become my husband and my partner in this wonderful world of musicals. 1964 and 1967, I played comedy opposite Richie. and taking a break then in 1965 to get married, and after that then to have a family. But in 1971 we decided maybe we should set up a musical society in Clara, which we did, and we should be 50 years going this year, but whether we'll get to celebrate it or not remains open. We've always had a great partnership with Tullamore, coming and going from each other's societies, and to this day it's still very strong.
1964 saw the first outing for Oklahoma, a huge success for the town, and the society was starting to see some major players coming to the fore in leading roles. One of those people was Anna Brown.
Anna Brown, she was my first cousin, first of all, and she was a jack of all trades. She was president, she was chairperson, she was secretary, she took on any job, and she was a great individual, fantastic. And above all, she was a great actress. And I have to say, I learned more from Anna Brown than anything, and I owe nearly everything that I did on stage to Anna.
My first musical to attend in Tullamore was 1964, Oklahoma. Anna was in that show and she played the part of Ado Annie. She was absolutely brilliant. And so much so, I decided to join the society in 1965. And the show they were doing was White Violets. Anna, to me, was the musical society, as well as all her performances. She was a committee member and she held every position and very involved in all administration duties, i.e. the selection of musical directors, stage directors, production directors, and even, yeah, all positions like that. And she was also PRO for a long time, and that was her absolute forte. And Anna kept us all on our toes. I know I learned a lot from Anna. Anna was nominated for Best Programme both in 1980 and 1981, and in 1982, Best Comedienne, Susan in Desert Sun. Another two people that were involved that time in the Musical Society, Tommy Brennan and Mona O'Reilly, they were involved in every aspect of the show, all the shows, and they were just two great characters and great, great members.
In 1965, the society presented Wild Violets, and this was a debut for a lady who would go on to become one of the most recognisable leading ladies for the society, Anne Coughlan.
I first joined the Tullamore Musical Society in 1965. Eddie Fleming and myself, we travelled from Kinnegad to Tullamore each night. Eddie was the male lead and I was the female lead. It was a very enjoyable show and we had great fun. When we were in St Mary's Hall also, we had to finish off of a Wednesday night, because Wednesday night was the bingo night. And in those years, we did them for 2 weeks. So it was very hard going, but no matter what, we got there and we all enjoyed it. In 1969, it was the Gypsy Princess, and the male lead of that was Paddy Norton, and I had the female lead. It was a really lovely show. I loved the music of this show. And I loved all the costumes as well. They were really nice. Peggy and I got on very well together in lots of shows, but that particular one was very nice and very important to us.
With a postponement in 1966, the society staged A Quaker Girl in 1967. This was the first year the society encountered a lady who would go on to shape, influence and drive the society for the next 30 years.
There were some great personalities in the society at the time, but Taurine O'Rourlane and Sundry was the fabulously formidable Eileen Cronin. As chorus mistress, Eileen pretty much held sway over all aspects of the society. And for me personally, she was tremendous mentor over those early years.
I've never met a woman more passionate about musical theatre than Eileen, and she was able to get around us even though we were pretty wild characters at the time.
Eileen was terrific. She used to host rehearsals in her sitting room, and you might get a little drop of the crater when you go up. I remember Mr. Nicholson and myself being up there, and Brian Hughes and Dave Smith and Doc Connor. Oh, there was a load. Michael Rabbit, as I remember specifically, and Noel Keeley, the year we did Finian's Rainbow, the three of us. She did a lot of work with us in that show, and it was much appreciated. And she was a terrific lady. She had a great sense of musical theatre, and people sought her out at Ames weekends as well, where she would play a piano from night until early morning.
Another testament to Eileen's huge contribution to and influence on the society was when they commissioned a trophy to be used in the Ames Awards, and now, to this day, the society winning the award for best chorus in the country received the Eileen Cronin Trophy. Audience were ecstatic about the 1972 offering of the Gypsy Barn. Another major happening in 1972 was the establishment of the Ames Award Scheme. The Gypsy Barn picked up two Ames nominations. First was Teresa Palmer in the category of Best Supporting Female, and second was for Best Chorus. Musical director and chorus master that year, and making his debut with the society, was a man who would go on to hold the TMS baton for many years to come, John Gilligan.
1972, I remember John Gilligan coming to our house on Knockowen Road. That's where the final night of the Gypsy Barn of that year, the cast party was in our house. And that's the first time I came across John Gilligan. He was a terrific man, and he was musical director and chorus master for that show, and that was the first year that Tullamore Musical Society won a nomination for Best Chorus, and John was MD and chorus master.
1976 saw a production of The Golden Years and a change of venue for the society as it moved to the renowned Bridge House Hotel.
I first joined Tullamore Musical Society back in the early 1970s. At that time, all the shows were staged in St. Mary's Hall, now the Parish Centre. Then in 1977, we moved to the Bridge House, which was to become our home for the following 15 years. Despite limited facilities for staging big musicals, we managed to overcome all those obstacles, and we staged some great shows at that venue. Happy memories I have of those years were the fantastic sing-songs that followed the shows each evening. Eileen Cronin led the way on the piano, and she was prepared to keep playing as long as we all kept singing. I also took part in the Curtain Up Quiz, a quiz program based on musicals broadcast on RTÉ Radio. Eileen Cronin and Anna Brown were my two colleagues on that team. Sadly, those two ladies no longer with us. We managed to win that competition on a few occasions, proving that we were a very strong team. I would encourage all young people to please join the local musical society. It's a great pastime, great way to meet new friends, and a great way to have loads of fun and crack.
Throughout the rest of the 70s, the society was introduced to another wave of new faces that would go on to become some of the town's favourite performers for many years.
Well, I joined the Tullamore Musical Society in 1976, and it was my first role, and I played the part of Etty in The Golden Years of Percy French. I was 16 years old, and I suppose probably a lot of you weren't even born then. But anyway, the day of the dress rehearsal, I was at my sister's wedding, and it was in the Bridge House, and I was bridesmaid, and Brian Hughes was best man to my future brother-in-law Ray. So we had a great day at the wedding. Everything went according to plan. But the show, you must remember, was in the Bridge House, and the dress rehearsal was that night. The wedding was over at 6 p.m. and we had to go for the dress rehearsal at 7. The show must go on. So this is the programme from back 1976. Look at the state of it. Anyway, thanks for the memories.
So I joined in 77, I think. That's my first show. Showboat. Eileen Cronin inveigled me to go in. So I went in, and my recollection of the show actually was, I think it was a bit of a disaster.
The 1980s saw the society go from strength to strength, both on a local and national level, with many top quality shows and dozens of Ames nominations to boot. It's fair to say that they'd settled into their newest home and could really play to their strengths. Great reviews and huge attendances and reactions were par for course in the early shows of the 1980s. The Belle of New York, the White Horse Inn, and in 1982, the Desert Song. 1984 brought Paint Your Wagon and a first leading role for a gentleman who would go on to become synonymous with the society.
My own introduction to TMS occurred when, unknown to me, a member of the society spotted me in the middle of a sing-song in the Bridge House during the afters of a wedding. And about a week later, I received a letter in the post inviting me to a rehearsal for the Belle in New York, which I duly attended out of curiosity more than anything else.
There was more huge success for the society in 1985 with Finian's Rainbow, and in 1986 with their second offering of The Gypsy Barn, with both shows combining with 9 Ames nominations. And one of those who took home the coveted award for Best Male Singer and was about to make a name for himself as a hugely successful singer on the national stage was Dave Lawler.
I joined the society, I think it was 81. And the only reason I did, to be honest, was because Eileen Cronin sent me a letter, something strange nowadays for people, but sent me a letter to say that they were short of men for a show they were doing, which was called The White Horse Inn, if my memory serves me right. And would I come down and help them out? And thought about it for a while, talked to Marie about it, and I did. And that's how I got into the Musical Society. I went down, first night or two I was a little devious about it, I suppose, but after that I just got to know the guys, the crack started, and the crack went on until 1991 when I finished. It was just a fabulous time. I loved the shows, I loved the parts I got to play, and I'm so lucky to get them because there was huge competition for them. Then in the mid-80s when I won the awards, nominated a couple of times and was lucky enough, and I think it was 86 I won the award up in Newcastle. Oh God, what a weekend that was. What a time. It was absolutely fabulous. My time in the Musical Society was terrific. Loved every minute of it.
The finest singing ever heard in Tullamore was Jeff Oakley's headline to describe 1988's production of The Student Prince. And in 1989, the society switched ends in the Bridge House Ballroom for a hilarious production of Gilbert and Sullivan's HMS Pinafore. 1990 saw a production of Oh Susanna, which earned the society 2 Ames nominations, in the same category. Anne Hickey and Camilla McLaughlin were both nominated for Best Supporting Female, with Camilla bringing home the award.
Well, I have very fond memories of the Musical Society. I remember when I joined first, we used to have the shows in the Bridge House, which I really, really enjoyed because I always thought there was a great atmosphere in the Bridge House. And then afterwards, we would all retire to the lounge where there would be sing-song with the great Eileen Cronin, Lord mercy on her, and she would play well into the wee hours of the morning. Now, I don't know whether the Bridge House was a great venue for the audience because there was such a thing called restricted view, which meant you were sitting basically behind a pillar and you saw nothing. So if you wanted to see, you had to go like this. So then we moved to the GAA, which was had a huge stage, of course, and that was brilliant. But yeah, of course, I was on the stage with all the greats, Frank Nicholson, Brian Hughes, Doc Connor, the great Dave Lawler, of course, who was the heartthrob at the time. But look, it was great. We had great times. And of course, Dave Smith, I always remember him in Paint Your Wagon, which was probably one of the funniest shows I certainly was ever in anyway, because I think I laughed my way through the whole thing. I remember laughing into poor Frank Nicholson's face on stage as he played the sheriff. He was just so funny.
1990 was also the last production to take place in the Bridge House Hotel. It was the end of an era for the society, and it's fair to say that they were going to miss the place that they had called home for the previous 14 years.
The sing-songs were magical. Christy Mayo, you know, he was a magical man, a great host, kind of let us do anything to his premises and loved us, loved the crack, he loved the fun, he loved the after-show fun. I don't think that goes on today, but it certainly was part of our social scene.
A new decade and a new venue for Tullamore Musical Society, moving to the GAA Centre. The next few years saw more and more success with productions of Fiddler on the Roof, Clown, Guys and Dolls, Oliver and Calamity Jane. But the new era for the society in its newest venue began in 1991 and another wonderful production of Oklahoma.
Sweet when the wind comes right behind the rain. Oklahoma, every night, my honey, land and I, every night we sit alone and talk and watch a hawk making lazy circles in the sky. We know we belong to the land, and the land we belong to is grand. Yippee, 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 we know we belong to the land, and the land we belong to is grand. And when we say, yo, hi-yi-pi-yo, hi-yi, we're only saying, you're doing fine, Oklahoma, Oklahoma, O-K-L-A-H-O-L-A.
Also during the 90s, we were introduced to two leading ladies that wowed audiences in Tullamore for years to come.
What a blast. I had a fabulous 4 years there in total. My memories, actually I was catapulted on the stage. I arrived in Tullamore on December 28th, knocked on the door, asked to come down and give a dig out by Brian Gunning. And I went down, which I thought I was doing backstage, and ended up singing at the piano beside Eileen Cronin, small Lizzie Willie Fragger, and I was saying, you sing. Mm-hmm. And I said, I do. And she threw this thing at me, to sing this. And then she just turned around and said, she'll do. And I remember Anna Brown and Marie Hughes looking at me, knowing I was really nervous, and saying to me, Kathy, you know what? You've got this, but you just need to let Valencia on loose. And that changed my entire performance. And it was the rest is history. I ended up doing Hoddle the following year with Frank Nicholson, who is a Tevye, completely different to what you'd expect, and he made me actually believe he was my dad. He was incredible to be on stage with Nippy Norton on stage for Clan. I mean, I was supposed to be really sad at it, and Nippy Norton's there. When he comes out on stage, all he wanted was burst out laughing. So I had to turn around and learn how to dampen down my giddiness. It's just so many memories. Sheila McDermott, designer, you know, come in and said, "You really need to dress that neck, Kathy, with that dress." And before I knew it, I was bejeweled with our stuff. And that just, I learned so much, met so many people, have loads of friends. And thank you, everybody. It was a blast. Love to you all.
What can I say about Tullamore Musical Society? Whenever I think of it, I start laughing. I mean, I've had just so many good memories of all the different shows we did, the wonderful friends I made. Just a story after story came into my head. I swear to God, I think I've had a smile on my face since you asked me to do this, because it has just brought back so many memories to me from Calamity Jane. I still have scars in my legs from Calamity Jane, and just every single show, the stories with every single one of them, but just the wonderful camaraderie and the, I suppose, the after hours nearly as much fun as the actually on stage time. But wonderful and great to have been part of it for 10 years. Just as I said, happiest days of my life. Love them, every minute of them.
Once again, with a changing of venue meant leaving behind many memories and many great, great stories.
I joined Tullamore Musical Society in 1992 to have fun, just to have the crack. And I certainly did have fun and have the crack. During the 90s, in particular, when we were in the GAA, it was just simply, it could not have been more enjoyable. It was absolutely wonderful time.
I remember the days of the GAA from around 91 to 2000. We did 10 shows there. The crack we had in there was absolutely brilliant. What would happen was once the shows would be finished, we'd be absolutely buzzing. We'd have a few drinks in the downstairs bar. Then we'd head upstairs then around, I know, maybe around 2 o'clock we'd head upstairs, and the crack would really get going then. We'd a few more pints, sing song around the piano, and Stevie McDermott looking after us so well. And I remember Stevie then, he'd give me a nod and a wink, and we'd head downstairs to the kitchen then. There'd be trays and trays of sandwiches ready to roll. So we'd eat a few down there. Then we'd bring the trays up to the multitude upstairs and feed them, and the crack would continue to the early hours of the morning. Then time to go home then, and you'd meet people going to 8 o'clock mass on the way home. They were absolutely brilliant days.
Move over Titanic, a better show has come to Tullamore. Jeff Oakley's opinion on the 1998 production of Jesus Christ Superstar. The show took the town by storm with record box office numbers. The Society wrapped up the decade with a production of West Side Story and a Showstoppers concert in the Tullamore Court Hotel, which saw many Society members past and present coming together to perform hits from the best-loved musicals. Whilst many of our members of the Society get a bow and the well-deserved adulation from the audience, there have been many, many people throughout the years who worked tirelessly behind the scenes. And without these people, we would have no society.
Every business in Tullamore really is probably terrified to see Natalie Watts coming. She just is there to beg, borrow, steal if she has to, although I don't like to do that because it's against the rules, honestly. But maybe we should say beg, borrow or barter, because I'm very good at that. And I've been collecting props for many, many years. Emptying out people's businesses, saying, "Ooh, I like that over there. Ooh, I like that over there." And then I also would be collecting patrons and sponsors' money and organising tickets and bringing tickets and collecting things from them. So, yeah, they kind of see me coming and think, "Oh, what does she want now?"
I got involved with TMS in 2010 when I was approached to build a set for Fiddler on the Roof. And a couple of years later, I was asked what a stage manager to Hot Mikado. And I've been doing both for the Society ever since. I suppose the stage management and backstage crew, we have a very tough yet rewarding job. And we partly have to work in the dark, setting scenery and furniture. While backstage, then we make sure everything's neat, tidy, that everything has a place. So the cast can move freely and on and off the stage with ease. And that, of course, is impossible without the fantastic crew that we have in TMS. And not only are these people from Tullamore, but they're from Ballycumber, Clara, Carrick, Portlaoise, and the surrounding areas. I've more or less had the same crew since the day I started with TMS, and I look forward to doing many more shows in the years to come.
The front of the house is one of the most important parts of the Musical Society as far as I'm concerned. Well, without the front of the house, the Musical Society couldn't go on, really, because you have to have people to steward it, look after the comings and goings of the customers. So, for that reason alone, I said that the front of the house is very important. During my time on the front of house committee, we had several successes in the Ames Awards. So it was a great assistance to the society to get those awards. During my time, I got to work with many great people, and such as Tommy Brennan, with a long, long career in front of house.
Back then, we used to store all the sets and the stage in an old warehouse. It was a disused building, belonging to Christy May, I think. And it was a lot of lugging, getting volunteers to bring 40 or 50 sheets over and back every year. Heartbreaking stuff. And one day, just fire was seen there, and the whole thing went up in a ball of smoke. And after that, then, sure, we had to go and build a new stage.
I think the Musical Society can't operate without the absolutely fantastic businesses we have in the town. They are our lifeblood for, like I said, props, patrons and sponsors, and all the things that we rely on, and they are fantastic, because every one of them, they couldn't give you enough, and they try to think with you, they'll go out of their way to help you any which way you can to make it the very best production. And at the end, it's lovely when they've come to see the show and they say, oh, I saw such a thing, or oh, I noticed, you know, something belonging to themselves, and they really feel that they are making a contribution as well to the Musical Society, as we all do.
A change of decade, and yes, you've guessed it, another change of venue for the Society as they move to the Tullamore Court Hotel and a production of Man of La Mancha. In 2002, the Society staged the Andrew Lloyd Webber rock opera Joseph and His Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, and a leading role for a man who was becoming one of the Society's favourites.
How would I describe my experience with the Tullamore Musical Society? Well, if I could remember half of it, it would be a start. My first introduction to stage would have been with the Tullamore Youth Centre. I was directed by the legend that is Sister Jenny. I think we'd done a show called Grease. And I suppose from there I got the bug. And I was fortunate not long after, or some might say unfortunate, to run into a guy called Nippy Norton. And he told me there was a show called Clown. I don't know if he was trying to tell me something, but he asked me if I'd be interested in turning up for auditions. And I did. And I was cast under the wonderful, now deceased, Eileen Cronin. And sure, look, the rest is history. I met some amazing legends. The best experience of my life. I'll never forget. Sorry. No, I'm just explaining how the Tullamore Musical Society was the second best experience of my life.
2003, and Tullamore got a whorehouse, and along with it, record box office receipts, as the Tullamore Court Hotel was jammed every night. It was also the first appearance for a lady who would go on to become one of the most recognisable faces of the society.
I first joined Tullamore Musical Society back in 2002. My family had moved from Edenderry to Tullamore, and at the time my parents had a shop in Hop Hill, and I was after finishing my Leaving Cert and was actually in college, and I didn't know anybody in Tullamore at the time. And I'd seen like advertisements of when shows were on, like Jesus Christ Superstar. And at the time I was going to Michael Moore in Tullamore, and I wanted for singing lessons, and I wanted to kind of like get involved in it, but I didn't know how to get in. And I remember keep plaguing my father to say, Dad, do you know anybody in the musical society? Because I don't know anybody here in Tullamore, and I don't have any friends. So when I'm coming home at the weekends, I've nothing to do and nowhere to go. So at the time, a member of the committee of Tullamore Musical Society, who everyone knows, Mr. Brian Gunning, lived in Hop Hill at the time, and my parents had a little grocery shop. So Brian used to be in and out and kind of chatting to Dad and stuff. So Dad knew that Brian was involved in the musical, and he said it to him. He was like, my daughter is absolutely mad to get involved. How can she do it? And Brian told him like when the next set of rehearsals were for the next show. And so it was in 2002, and the show that they were preparing for, of course, on my entry into the Musical Society, happened to be The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas.
2004 saw a hilarious production of Me and My Girl, and stepping into her first of many leading roles with the Society was Karen Martin.
So, Tullamore Musical Society started for me in 1999. I was in my transition year in school, and it was West Side Story. And we were in the Tullamore GAA, like we're back again. I have very fond memories of that year. I remember my first audition, and I remember being so terrified. I still get terrified going to auditions, but I was hooked ever since then. And I've been involved with as many shows as I could since then. And I have the most amazing memories from both on and off stage. And I have met the most incredible people who I'm very lucky to call my friends. And it's a great honour to be a member of my home society. And I can't thank them enough.
In 2005, it was 50 golden years for Tullamore Musical Society and a lavish production of The King and I. As a part of the 50th celebrations, the Society released a book, 50 Golden Years, The Story of Tullamore Musical Society. The man behind this publication, and behind much anticipated reviews of Society shows for the previous 30 years, was Jeff Oakley. In 2006, the Society staged an energetic and lively production of 42nd Street, and in 2007, the crowds were packed in for a highly entertaining production of Hello Dolly. Having played Anna in The King and I and other supporting roles over the years, Niamh Kilroy was nominated for her portrayal of Dolly Levi.
I was involved in Tullamore Musical Society for a few years, and I had the pleasure of working both backstage, front of house. I had some lovely roles in The King and I, Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, Hello Dolly. And I also had the great privilege and great learning experience of working on committee. And I really enjoyed every minute when I think of Tullamore Musical Society. I just want to laugh out loud. I have some lifelong friends from it. And just very funny experiences. For me, I suppose the scariest moment, it's always standing in the wings, just waiting to go on and thinking, oh my God, I actually can't remember any of my lines or any song, and I just can't go out there. And then once you step out onto the stage and the lights are shining on you, there is that scary moment. But then when you open your mouth, then you know, the show goes on, and it's just such a fantastic experience.
2008 saw another first for the Society with the production of Mac and Mabel. And in 2009, it was round three for the ever popular Oklahoma. In 2010, the Society brought Fiddler on the Roof to the town for the second time. And in 2011 was a premiere for the Society with a fun-filled, funky production of The Hot Mikado. These years saw the emergence of a new guard that would become the faces of the Society over the next decade.
So I joined TMS in 2008, 2009 for their production of Oklahoma. I remember walking into the audition room, and it was my first ever audition, and I sang the song, Oh What a Beautiful Morning, from start to finish in completely the wrong key. but I have managed to get a little bit better since then, and I've actually gone on and had a few leading roles with the society. The last one being Elle Woods in Legally Blonde. Probably my favourite memory of TMS was the last performance of The Witches of Eastwick. We had a problem with the rig that day, the flying rig, and I just remember poor Wayne Handy, our stage manager, doing his absolute best behind us, trying to get us up into the air to fly. And I remember looking side stage and just seeing all the cast and crew, and they were just like willing us to fly to get there. And we did. Wayne made it happen. We flew and we got a great reaction, and we actually went on to win Best Overall Show that year. So all the drama was well worth it.
I joined in 2006 for 42nd Street, and I've been in multiple shows since then. I lived in Dublin for a period, so I was travelling up and down for certain shows. But no matter what, if I was on stage or not, I was always there every single year, because there is nothing like the buzz of being involved with Tullamore Musical Society and the connections and the people that you meet. It just has this aura about it. And I can't, you can't describe the feeling you have when you're around like-minded people who accept you for you.
The Musical Society has given me so many memories over the past 13 years, both on stage, backstage, front of house, as a member of the production team, and most of all on committee. There have been ups, downs, tears, and plenty of laughter, and that goes with being in the society. A memory that stands out in particular is during our production of Oklahoma. I dislocated my knee on the second night, crawled off the stage in absolute agony, but luckily the show was saved with my body double Colin Hughes stepping in while also playing the role of Ali Hakim. I don't know how he did it, but Colin, know that I'm available whenever you need me. I got your back.
The Tullamore Court Hotel was packed all week for the Society's first ever production of Beauty and the Beast in 2012. And playing the title role in Annie Get Your Gun the following year was a girl who had played many leading roles previously and many more to come, Amanda Cunningham.
So I joined Tullamore Musical Society back in 2001, 20 years ago, when I auditioned for Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. It was and still is the most terrifying day of my life, but absolutely the best decision I ever made. I think if you ask anyone who's been involved in any Tullamore show over the years, that, you know, somebody will have a funny story to tell, a lot of funny stories to tell about rehearsals and, you know, on stage blunders, you know, where somebody just forgets a line or forgets to show up, and there's like a horrifying silence on stage, which seems to last forever when you're up there, but probably not noticeable to an audience, I hope. but I think what I'll take away most from Tullamore eventually is just lifelong friendships. I mean, TMS is this big, crazy family that I always like to think we're going to end up in the nursing home together, you know, putting on this like full-scale production of Grease, probably in our 90s and still thinking that we can pass for 16 or 17. But there are a lot more shows and a lot more memories to make.
In 2014, the Society took another big step with another venue change and a move back to the GAA Centre for a production of the ever-favourite Annie.
But on our opening show, I made a big mess of the whole thing. About half an hour in, I gave this line which moved the show on about 15 minutes and left out a whole chunk of stuff. The whole development of the relationship between Daddy Warbucks, who I was playing, and Annie just went out the window. So we went from this nuisance brat of a kid who had arrived in to this girl that I was treating like my own long-lost daughter. And the audience must have been thinking, have we missed something here? But worse, The cast who had just left the stage from a big song and dance number and would have had maybe 15 minutes to get ready for the next number had to come straight back on because I had gone on to the next song. And I went off stage after the scene and blissfully unaware of what had happened and kind of chuffed with myself. The show was going well and people were looking at me like, what have you done? Anyway, it was funny. We got to the end of the night and I suppose the show never really recovered on that particular night. It got better as the week went on, but I'm sure people went home thinking we definitely missed something there.
And in 2015, it was a production of the Elvis jukebox musical All Shook Up and a first Tullamore appearance for Chris Caroon.
I have been a member of Tullamore Musical Society for the past 6 years now, although it seems a lot longer. I joined them back when they did their production of All Shook Up back in 2015, and I've been a part of the fold ever since, part of the family. I've had huge opportunities to play some fantastic roles with Tullamore Musical Society. I played Chad in All Shook Up, Judge Turpin in Sweeney Todd, Daryl Van Horn in Witches of Eastwick, which to date is my favourite show I've ever done. Everything about the show is just spectacular. And I also got the part of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, which I was very lucky enough to be nominated for and win Best Male Singer in 2019.
During the next few years, the Society's productions went to another level. Being sold out before opening night had become the norm, and this all culminated in 2016 with the winning of Best Overall Show at the annual Ames Awards for Tullamore Musical Society's production of The Witches of Eastwick.
Winning Best Overall Show was an incredible experience. There was something about witches that year, a real sense of magic. It had been really well received by the public, by friends and by family. So I'd be lying if I said there wasn't a sense of anticipation heading to the Ames ceremony in Killarney. We knew we had something really, really special. But nothing had prepared us for the feeling of actually winning Best Overall Show. For me, it was an overall sense of pride. I had been involved with the Society since 1998. I had joined as part of the children's chorus in Jesus Christ Superstar. And I hadn't really looked back since. It had become so much a part of my life and still is. I feel like I've given it so much over the years, but in return it has given me so much, and particularly that year, it was really special.
So I will probably go down in the history of Tullamore Musical Society as one of the worst secretaries. One of the roles of the secretaries is to book in the Ames adjudicator, and Ames had made a rule in 2016 that you must give at least 8 weeks notice to book an adjudicator, and if you haven't done that, then your show is simply not going to be adjudicated. I totally forgot to do this and I applied the first week in January, and our show was on in February, 6 weeks later. And I got a letter back to say, unfortunately, you missed the deadline and you're not going to be adjudicated. And we were putting on The Witches of Eastwick in the GAA. So I had, with a heavy heart, to go in and first of all inform the committee. And then I had to go and I had to address the entire cast because it was my fault. And it was such a bummer because everyone was having so much fun. And now, and we had a great show on our hands, or we knew we were getting there. And then, you know, it wasn't going to be adjudicated in the circuit with Ames. So anyway, everyone was really good to me. They took it on the chin, but it was horrifically disappointing. And then as the momentum built on the show and we knew that we had a great show on our hands, at the end of the week, at the last night at the bar in the GAA, I had Paul Norton and Niall Mulpeter come up to me and they were like, we have to get this done again and we have to get this adjudicated. It needs to be seen. Do you think you can do anything? So I went back, put a play to the committee. They all got behind it and we brought Witches of Eastwick back for popular demand. But in all, it was back by popular demand for two nights, but also gave us an opportunity to get the show adjudicated, and how well that worked out for us because we won Best Overall Show.
The Society's success, both nationally and locally, during these years, along with other factors, was largely down to the establishment of a production team featuring two Society favourites going back nearly 30 years.
In 2013, 21 years after I'd first appeared with Tullamore, Aoife Fitzsimons rang me and offered me the job of directing for Tullamore Musical Society. I immediately accepted. I was over the moon to be given this opportunity to direct for my home society. It is a society I hold dearly, that my parents held dearly, that two of my three children had appeared on stage with. It was a huge honour. To date, I have directed the last 7 consecutive shows for Tullamore. 8, if you include the last 5 years, which we did as a fundraiser. These shows have been tremendously successful. The standard we've got to in Tullamore with them has been massive, and I'm extremely proud of the work that has been done by everyone in Tullamore. On these 7 shows, I worked with different musical directors, but I worked with a consistent choreographer, Graham Finnerty, and I can wholeheartedly state that the standard we got to the shows wouldn't have happened without Graham on the production team with me. He was simply outstanding in not just a choreography, but as his visuals are superb. He's a collaborator, and we worked superbly well together. It was a pleasure to work alongside him.
When I became involved with the society on stage in 1996, it wasn't even in the back of my mind that I could one day be lucky enough to be part of the production team for one of their shows. Luckily, the committee decided to take a risk on an unknown choreographer a number of years ago with the support of Nippy at the time, and I would be forever grateful to them for taking that risk. Tullamore has such a wealth of onstage talent to choose from and to pull from. It has been an honour to sit on the production team that has been able to pull from that talent to cast these phenomenal shows that we've put together over the last number of years.
Audiences were blown away by the stunning 2019 production of Jekyll and Hyde. And in February 2020, the Society staged its 64th production, Legally Blonde.
God knows where we'll be tomorrow. God knows what the future has in store. God knows if it's happiness or sorrow, or if we'll find the dreams we're looking for. God knows if we all will be together.
Looking back through the years, shows and people involved since 1955, it's fair to say that Tullamore Musical Society has had a hugely positive impact on many people's lives. Whether being on stage, involved with the society off stage, or to our wonderful audience members who support us so well every year.
I didn't really have a choice when it came to being a part of Tullamore Musical Society. In fact, some of my earliest childhood memories are of going to the Bridge House in the 1980s to the musicals with Mam and Dad. Dad being on stage and Mam being front of house, and just being in absolute awe of everything that was Tullamore Musical Society. The people, the shows, everything. So that's what started it for me. I've been very, very lucky that stage and theatre is now a huge part of my life. I've been very lucky to pave a career for myself in it. And I would think that without my family connections to Tullamore Musical Society, that wouldn't have been the case. I've met the greatest people. I have the greatest stories and the greatest memories of my time with Tullamore Musical Society to date. And I'm looking forward to many, many more.
TMS for me has just been brilliant for meeting new people, creating lifelong friendships, and just, you know, being in a room with people that are like-minded and just want to have a bit of fun and be a little bit silly on stage.
If you had told me in 1992, the night I rocked up to the GAA to join the chorus of the Merry Widow, that 30 years later I would be still involved in musical theatre, still loving every moment of it, being able to leave a job I had quite early in life and now make my living full-time in musical theatre, I would have said you are absolutely bonkers, you're crazy.
It's quite amazing that I'm a very small part of such a huge history of society over 65 years and think that we are still going strong as one of the top musical societies in the country is pretty incredible, and it's a testament to those people that started the society.
The standard of shows that Paul Norton and Graham Finnerty have been doing with the society over the last number of years have been fantastic, and it's certainly in great shape going forward, and I look forward to many, many more productions and doing front of house and enjoying the crack with everybody.
My favourite memories of the Tullamore Musical Society was the happiness.
We now have people who are experts in costume design and stage management, stage design, lighting design, and it has been incredible to watch. It has also fed in, I think, to the success of the society on a local and national level. And that success, like to be part of that success with any society around the country, it would have been amazing for me as a choreographer. But to be part of that with your home society, surrounded by your best friends in the world, it has been absolutely magical.
It's terrific to see that the musical society is still going today, and that they're still winning awards and still putting on even better shows probably than we did now with technology and everything. It's absolutely fabulous. But my time from 81 to 91 in the Musical Society was probably one of the best times of my life, and I'll never forget it. And still have the friends today, and enjoyed every minute of it.
Okay, looking back on the 20 years or so I spent on stage with Tullamore Musical Society, I can't help but smile. The music and the shows and the crack and the friends we made that are still there 40 years on. It was really great and a pleasure and a privilege to have been a part of it all.